Chapter 9. Decide what you want. There is no more miserable human being than one in whom nothing is habitual but indecision. William James. There can be no gainsaying that once you have made up your mind to do a thing, it will be done. But the trouble with most of us is that we sidestep, vacillate, backtrack, detour, and seldom make up our minds to do what we want or determine clearly the road on which we wish to travel. All daydreams and wishes could become realities if we kept them constantly before us, put fear behind, shoved away all reservations, ifs, ands, and buts. Again, many of us think we know what we want, when as a matter of fact, we don't. This sounds paradoxical, but if we all knew what we wanted, we would get it, provided we had the willpower, the stamina, the dynamic force, the fight to go after it. The world is divided into two classes of people, the I-willers and the should-I or shouldn't-I-ers, and this latter class includes the great majority of men and women. How many times have you said to yourself, should I or shouldn't I? More human lives have been wrecked on the shoals of indecision than from any other cause. That's something the creative power within cannot magnetically attract things to you unless it is magnetized by your decision. A magnet cannot attract in two directions at once. Its magnetic force must be centered upon some definite object. You can demonstrate this by passing a magnet over a pile of iron filings. When you point the magnetized end of the magnet at any specific place in the pile, the iron filings are drawn instantly to it. Move the magnet away from this section, and its power diminishes in proportion to the distance and direction. When you are pulling against yourself, mentally and emotionally, you are confusing, stalemating, and even destroying your magnetic powers of attraction for the time being. An unsettled condition of mind and body can only attract unsettled conditions. It has no power to attract anything else. The great lament of thousands upon thousands of human beings is, I can't make up my mind. This is one of the saddest dirges ever to rise from human hearts, because it sounds the death knell of hope, ambition, self-confidence, initiative, accomplishment. As long as you can't make up your mind, you are comparatively helpless, unable to move in any direction with assurance or with any feelings of safety and security. My mind is like an unmade bed, one woman said to me. It's all in a jumble. I'm afraid to make it up. I'm afraid to touch it, for fear I'll make it even worse. I guess I'll just leave it as it is. Do you wish to remain where you now are? If you do, just don't make up your mind. Unless you change your thinking, you will stay in whatever position you find yourself. Either that, or you will sink to a lower position, because nothing stands still in life. It moves either up or down. Metal rusts if nothing is done to keep it polished and free of disintegrating forces. You can't drop behind in the parade of life. You must keep going, for your own sake, at any age. Nature abhors anything that surrenders its usefulness. The buzzards are always waiting to do a clean-up job on forms of life that give up the struggle. Sounds pretty grim? It's not meant to be. Something has been provided to take care of everything in all the various stages of life activity and what is called death. In your body, millions of old cells are dying and new cells are being born all the time. You are unconscious of it. The same is true of ideas. As you grow in experience, you are killing off old ideas in your mind and giving birth to new ones. If you don't do this, the old, outmoded ideas clog up your mind, slow up your thinking, rust your brain, retard your progress, and eventually bog you down. If you are finding that you can't make decisions the way that you used to, it's probably because you are wrestling with old ideas, old thought patterns, old habits and desires which you can't let go of, even when your voice within tells you to throw them overboard, get out of the rut, and get doing what you inwardly know you should be doing. Have you come to the Red Sea place in your life where, in spite of all you can do, there is no way out, there is no way back, there is no other way but through? Annie Johnson Flint. If this is your state of mind and situation in life at the moment, it is good. If your back is against the wall, if you've been pushed by indecision and circumstances of your own conscious or unconscious creation as far as you can go, then there is no other way but through. So face reality. Reorient yourself. Reorganize your scattered forces. Make up your mind and move straight ahead. Decide. Then, act. Many men and women have reached the seeming limit of their endurance, only to find new strength awaiting them in their hours of desperate need, once they reached a positive decision, once they said to themselves, and meant it, "I'll face it. I'll see this thing through." There is no 11th hour too late wherein that something, the creative power within, cannot be magnetized by right thought and right decision and give you the strength and wisdom to pull out. God spoke to me in my great moment of need. Thousands of grateful men and women have testified. They mean that they finally were driven to call upon their God-given inner resources after trying everything else and failing, and the inner power, which they might have used all along, answered their summons. Don't make the mistake of thinking that you can ever succeed by using your conscious mind alone. The egotist likes to pretend he's done it all for himself, through sheer willpower and physical force. He pats himself on the back and says, "Look at me, I'm a self-made man." But let this egotist suffer a setback in business or his private life and watch his ego deflate. He goes around with his hat pulled down around his ears, his chin stuck down in his coat collar, his eyes staring at the ground, mumbling to himself, "I can't understand how this could have happened to me." Yes, you can get somewhere on your own physical drive by conscious connivance, manipulation, a cleverness of wit, deceit, and a "it's who you know" philosophy. But what you gain by force, you eventually lose by force. You have no staying power. Someone else, using the same dog-eat-dog tactics, kicks you off the road or steamrollers you. Then, because you have misused your real powers within, if you have used them at all, you are lost. For the first time in your life, perhaps, You are scared. You have no more faith in the methods you employed to get where you were, and you have little or no faith in your fellow man or in God. The world is a pretty barren place, and you are the most barren creature in it. Worst of all, your confidence in self and in everything else has been so shattered that you can't decide what to do about it. Stop bemoaning your fate. Get wise to yourself. You have only two choices. You can either go higher or lower. You may take to drink or help yourself to a first-class nervous breakdown, or wander around through the rest of your life moaning about what might have been if you had only lived your life differently, but telling yourself it's too late now. But if you belong to that smaller percentage of men and women who have gotten wise to themselves, you discover that it is never too late to get on the right track. You discover that you have been passing up the most wonderful force in your life, the creative power within, which has been ready and willing at all times to serve you. A deep feeling of humility steals over you, and you lose your falsely assumed attitudes of egotism and self-importance forever. Once you are down to the bedrock, you find that you have a foundation on which to build, that you can pick up your life again and make something of it, something finer than ever before. Perhaps not so flashy or so gaudy, but so much more worthwhile, self-satisfying, healthful, and enjoyable. Now, at last, you can decide what is best for you, without worrying what the other fellow is going to do to you, unless, perhaps, you do it to him first. There has come to you the inner assurance that whatever you really need can and will be supplied to you by your creative power, if you keep in attunement with it and direct it by right mental picturing. Not only this, but you realize that you have been missing out on many things in life of far greater value than many of the things you thought you had to have a short time ago. Perhaps, in a radical sense, you do not fit into this category just depicted. But in a lesser sense, we all fit. It is human to make mistakes, human to permit certain emotional desires to get the better of us, to carry us far afield from our real purposes and potentialities in life. I knew better, but I did it anyway, many sadder and wiser people say, after they have gotten a new hold on themselves and snapped out of their departure from sane, happy, healthful living. If you have reached the snapback stage, now is the time. There is no other time for you but now. If you don't do it now, you'll never do it. You have reached your moment of decision. There is no way out. There is no way back. There is no other way but through. Take the plunge. Pull yourself out. Face whatever you have to face and get it over with. The longer you delay, the harder it will be. Decision always magnetizes. Decision starts an immediate magnetic action in your mind, which rearranges the iron filings of your life, reassembles the broken pieces, fits them together in a new fabric, strengthens the weak spots, and gives you new vitality and resolution to do what the inner voice dictates. Take direction from your real self within. Follow its urgings, no matter how difficult it may seem at the moment. Ask forgiveness of those you have wronged. Clear up all past resentments and hatreds. free your consciousness of past fears and inhibitions so your mind can become a channel for good thoughts and can begin to help you attract good things to you. Get away from David Hareham's indecisive yes and no and maybe, maybe not. This will never get you anywhere. Who wants to live a miserable yes and no and maybe not existence? I'd rather make a wrong decision and do something about it than make no decision at all, a successful businessman told me. If I'm on my toes, I can usually tell whether a decision is wrong or not before it hurts me too much. And out of this wrong decision, I then have the wisdom to make a right one. But if I make no decision at all, I get nowhere. It takes courage and faith to make many decisions. But the happy, well-integrated man or woman is he or she who dares to act without hesitation on the basis of the best judgment and intuition at the moment. Joseph Addison is credited with the statement, "The woman that deliberates is lost." What indecision does. I am thinking now of a woman who is in love with two men at the same time. Both wanted to marry her, and she kept them dangling, unable to make a decision between them for over a year. Finally, she made her choice, but confided to her mother on her wedding day that she feared she had made a mistake. She carried this uncertainty into her marriage, always wondering whether or not she would have been happier with the other man. This would I or wouldn't I mental state upset her emotionally and reflected upon her sexual relations with her husband. She became frigid, worrying about the decision she had made, afraid to confess her real feelings to her mate. But one night, in utter exasperation, he exploded. "I wish to hell you had married Bill," and she impulsively cried out, "I wish to hell I had too." This release of tension, bringing the subject out into the open, helped her to face herself. She realized then that she had been giving herself a fictitious build-up, that her quality of indecision had caused her to divide her emotional feelings between the two men, and if any little thing went wrong in the association between the man she had chosen and herself, she pictured, to salve her own hurt feelings, a perfect relationship existing between herself and the man she had not married. "I'm sure now that I really love you," she told her husband, "that I didn't make any mistake when something inside told me that you were the one. I'm sorry I've been so silly and juvenile about things, but it's pretty hard to break the habits of a lifetime." Make your positive decision now. If indecision has you in its grip, break this lifetime habit. If you don't, you'll be miserable the rest of your life, and your percentage of wrong decisions will attract many more wrong conditions to you. The voice within cannot get through to you when you are in an emotional and mental state of indecision. A preacher relative of mine became disturbed in thought when a young man. His studies led him to doubt certain parts of the Bible. He began to censure himself for teaching what he could no longer believe. This developed a conflict within him, a plaguing wonderment. Am I doing right or wrong by continuing in the ministry? Finally, he developed asthma and would get attacks just before going into the pulpit on Sunday. It was nature's way of keeping him from saying what he felt he shouldn't say. His body was reflecting a condition of his mind. He finally retired from the ministry on the plea of ill health, not confessing his religious misgivings even to his wife. For 30 years, this highly intelligent man lived a life of torture. The asthmatic attacks would be most severe at times when he was wrestling with himself over sins of omission and commission. Did I do right, or didn't I? I had a talk with this relative near the end of his life. He said that he just had to get something off his mind. When he told me what had been troubling him all these years, he wanted to know if I thought he would be damned for this. I assured him that I thought the God power in this universe was too big and understanding to condemn or to damn any human being, that we all make mistakes, that this was the only way that any of us could grow, through mistakes. Then he said to me, "Oh, if only I had my life to live over, I would have left the church and I would have turned to writing and expressed my convictions, honestly, openly, because I realize now, too late, that many men and women had been thinking as I was thinking. But I let fear and indecision and self-condemnation keep me from my real life work." Many people, when confronted with two possible courses of action and not sure which is right, try to do both, usually to their sorrow. No one has been able to go very far in two directions at the same time. You must make a choice, and you can generally make the right choice if you will let the voice within guide you. But it is always tempting to listen to the voice of our emotions, our personal or prejudiced desires, which too often lead us astray. Shakespeare had his Hamlet say what many of us in our troubled minds have said: "To be or not to be, that is the question. Whether 'tis nobler in the mind to suffer the slings and arrows of outrageous fortune, or to take arms against a sea of troubles, and by opposing, end them." And then, to paraphrase, "But then the dread of what may happen makes us rather bear those ills we have than fly to others that we know not of." How easy it is, when we are beset with ills of one kind and another, to picture greater ills, and to decide to put up with the ills we have, rather than attempt to rise above them, and thus, we fear, encounter other ills we know not of. Decision is born of courage, and courage springs from faith in self and in the God power within. Why go on picturing a continuation of the problems and conditions which may be surrounding you now? Decide to do away with them by resolutely changing the pictures, thus giving that something within the power to change your future for the better.